Ham Radio Now, once again from the Huntsville Hamfest. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and we are going to talk about signage, publicizing, or at least promoting, not even publicizing, not even promoting, just bragging about yourself on at your ham radio shack. You know, if everybody were on television, these things would be even more important. Everybody's on radio, on ham radio. But when people come to your shack, first they look around at the mess, and then they need something to focus on that is going to show them that you have a little pride in your ham station. And here it is. Camera one, please. This is the... Oh, actually, I should have said camera four. Let's do camera four. There it is. There's the pretty item. And that is courtesy of Jim Thibeault, KF4NBG. Did I get that right? Did I write that
down there? That's correct.
From Jim's Engraving. And you just had a conversation sort of dovetailed with me over on QSO Radio with Ted Randall. And I was aware of your stuff. I'd seen it on Ham Nation. You'd actually made a pitch to me, do I want some of this for Ham Radio Now? And I was just busy, and, you know, I didn't get around to it and all that. And then you said something on the interview with Ted Randall that caught my attention. It's the way you make these. And this this display that we have right here is only at about 25% of its true character because it's not lit. It takes 12 volts, and we couldn't bring the 12 volts over. So it's beautiful, but if it were doing everything it should do, it would all be lit up. So that would be even prettier. But the technique that you described for making it caught my attention.
Are you talking about the engraving?
The engraving, yeah.
Yeah. What I do is I use a sand blaster. It's a standard sand blaster that you might find in any auto body shop. Only I use a finer grit abrasive.
When I think sandblasting, I'm thinking of cleaning off the brick on the outside of a building. It's a fire hose.
Removing rust.
Yeah. 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 This is clearly something different than that.
Yeah. What it is, it's an art form that's been around for about 20, 30 years. There are very few people that know how to do it, but it's getting to be big. It's starting to catch on, and a lot of people are doing it. Standard sandblast tank that you can buy in any auto body shop for removing rust and brick, cleaning bricks and stuff like that.
Okay, well, we probably don't even know what a standard sandblast tank is, so I guess it's pressurized.
Well, the tank itself is just a cabinet, and it's a pressurized, what I have is what's called a pressure pot that holds aluminum oxide, 180 grit, aluminum oxide blasting media.
So it's not sand.
No, it's not sand. No, it's sandish. It's a very fine grain aluminum oxide, or I can use silicon carbide.
And is it suspended in a liquid of some kind?
No, it's got to be completely dry liquid. It won't flow through the nozzle if it gets even the slightest amount of moisture. On a humid day, it's useless. So I've got to filter out all the moisture, make sure there's no moisture in it. Now, it's just pressured at about 35 pounds per square inch, and I blast it onto the back of whatever I'm doing. And whether it be a mirror, a coffee cup, I can engrave deeply into a coffee cup, beer mugs, glass, ceramics. I can actually take a picture of you and engrave it on my on a piece of marble.
So
using a sandblaster.
I'm guessing you're not doing this freehand.
No.
I'm way too detailed.
No, I'm doing the engraving freehand. I hold the glass or whatever I'm doing in the cabinet with a gun in my other hand. The way it's actually done is I design it on the computer. Then as you're familiar with back in the days of film contact prints?
Barely.
Where you take the negative and put it up against the paper, expose it to light, and that's what's called a contact print. Well, this is the same thing. I print off the artwork onto vellum paper. The artwork is black and white, pure black, pure white. And light can shine through the white part, but it can't get through the black. So, and I expose it onto ultraviolet light for about 60 seconds, and I wash it out, and that becomes a stencil. It's a one-shot stencil. I squeegee this on the back of whatever I'm engraving, and there's a cover sheet that comes off, and it becomes a stencil at that point. I just sandblast away.
Okay, so the sandblasting doesn't create the detail that we see.
No, it's a stencil.
It takes away everything else, leaving the detail from the stencil?
No, the detail you see is actually the sandblasted part.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I can do it either way, but 90% of what I do is I leave the sandblasting part. That's the part that's done.
Okay, so the letters here have been sandblasted.
Right.
And the black around it.
Right. It's like a stencil that you had back in school. There's an opening for, you know, drawing in, painting in, whatever. The same thing here. There'd be an opening, like, for every one of those lines you see there. There's an opening. I just sandblast it out.
Okay.
Simple as that. It's not hard. It just takes a long time to do it.
I was thinking like a really fine little pin with a kind of tiny but high-speed jet of stuff coming out.
This is blowing it away. Yeah, it blows away, a little jet. It's not a big hole.
Probably not too different from making a circuit board. Etching a circuit. Well, it's not etching.
Yeah, well, but the exposure is done the same way.
Yeah.
In fact, the exposure unit that I have was given to me. I had a simple one, but a friend of mine who used to do a lot of circuit boards gave me the exposure unit I have. It's much bigger, and that's what I use for exposing the vinyl,
okay.
Vinyl sandblast resist.
So this is sort of your premier model here.
Yes.
It's a weather station built in with the, and once again, this would be lit. I think we'll either go take a camera over to your table and shoot a few that are lit.
Oh, I appreciate that.
Or you probably got some pictures on your website, I imagine.
Oh, absolutely.
These all lit up.
Yeah.
That's going to be the easy way for me trying to stay away from field recording on this.
Mm-hmm.
Well, so we'll show some of those. And and your website is
www.jimsengraving.com.
Yeah, I'll give you a hint. You don't need to say www.
I know that. I know that.
Just everybody knows. Jimsengraving.com.
Yeah, Jimsengraving.com. That'll work fine.
Yeah. I mean, I work in radio production, and I'll see a piece of copy from some ad agency, and they'll have the website, and they've got a 30-second commercial, and they want to spend 10 seconds of it going www. Say, no, guys.
I know.
Let's cut that out. There are a few old websites that had to have that in there, but they're pretty much all gone by now. So is this the biggest thing you make, the most expensive piece?
No, I had a guy at Dayton order a big, huge base with a 4-1000 tube on it. That was the most expensive one I've done. That was about a $350 unit, but it had a 4-1000 tube, big mahogany base. Base was about 8 to 10 inches long, 12, 14 inches wide long.
Is it pretty much a custom deal?
I mean, it's a custom deal.
That doesn't come off an assembly line.
No. This one's going to come up an assembly line. This is my first time I've shown this one here.
Okay.
This is going to be on a regular basis.
All right. And when you say weather station, it's not like a Davis weather station. It's just got clock, barometer.
Hygrometer.
And thermometer.
Thermometer, yeah.
Okay, so you can get a quick what's going on inside your shack.
Inside
it's not going to show you what's
outside. It's an inside weather station.
Yeah, but I've just given you a marketing idea.
Yeah. Well, the other idea I've got, I sold two of these yesterday, and both of them, instead of the weather station, they wanted 4 clocks.
For different time zones.
Different time
sure,
zones.
Sure, that might be easy to do.
Yeah.
And you were saying that you started doing this because you got tired of being retired.
Yeah.
Not tired of working.
Yeah, I enjoy working.
What did you do for a living?
Most of the time I was in sales. Most good 11 years there in North Carolina. I did real estate, food. I'm sure you know the
angle. Cliff's going to want to talk to you about real estate here in a minute.
Well, I'm glad to be working now.
Pay attention, Cliff.
No, I work for the, in case you know, I'm sure you know who I'm talking about, the Angus Barn in Raleigh.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I work for the company that supplied them their beef. For a number of years.
It's what's for dinner. That's my audition for the
beef council. At the Angus Barn, some of the best in the country.
Yeah.
But anyway, I did that sales about 35 years. I spent my first 10 years of working life as a tool and die maker and got tired of working indoors, and I like being out with people. So I somehow ended up in sales, and that's what I did till I retired.
Okay. So the tool and die stuff might be a little more associated with it. Sales got nothing to do with what you're doing here.
If it hadn't been for my experience as a tool and die maker, I wouldn't be doing this today.
All right. So you went back to some roots.
Right.
Some old skills.
Absolutely.
And figured out what to do.
Yeah.
And is ham radio your only market, or have you tapped into, because this is universal. It doesn't have to have a call sign on it.
I'd say 90% of what I do is for ham radio. I do coffee cups and beer mugs. Like you said, ham radio operators love to show their stuff off. They love to, they're proud of their call sign. They work hard to get it, and they love to show it off. They're very proud of it. I've had a couple of these where people have made them just to put in the back window of their car and operate off their brake light.
Yeah, and
I like showing it off.
Again, the reason why we're not lit up here is it's designed to run off 12 volts.
Right.
For your display, you've got some batteries, but any 12 volt power supply, and it's LEDs, so not a lot of current.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the little flat display, but you were also talking about repurposing some old fancy-looking tubes that you do what with?
What I do is I, depends on the tube, I remove the metal bottom from it and desolder the prongs that come out of the bottom and make a hole in the wooden base and light them up with LEDs. And they light up extremely well. They really look nice.
Yep. And the color can be remotely controlled?
Remotely controlled, multicolor, red, green, blue, and white, or various shades of those colors.
And I guess automatically
either any color individually, or I can have it blink through all the colors extremely fast, or very slow fade from one to another. Most people keep it on a slow fade.
I don't want to trigger any seizures.
And most people keep them on 24/7. They don't use any electricity to speak of.
No
heat produced.
Yeah.
It makes a great night light throughout the house. I don't think mine's ever been shut off.
All right. Yeah. And your price range?
Anywhere for the average sale is about $200. I have some bases with engraved mirrors, a 9-inch base with a 6-inch engraved mirror for $140. I have a base for $100 even with a crystal globe. It's a 4.5-inch crystal globe. Or I can put a tube in that one base for $100 even. So my price range is from anywhere from $24 for a coffee cup all the way up to whatever anybody wants to spend.
Yeah,
I'll take their ideas.
They're all building totally custom things.
Yeah.
Do they have to supply some of the more esoteric materials? If they want a specific tube, I guess they better send you the tube.
If they want a specific tube, they have to send me the tube. They have to very heavily insure the tube because you put fragile in the box and the postal people will go postal on it.
Yeah, yeah. And these are tubes that have no more useful life.
No more useful life.
For transmitting or for whatever they were doing.
They're, right.
You know,
and I bought a bunch here.
For one reason or another.
Yeah, I bought a bunch here yesterday. I bought about 20 of them. In fact, the guy, before he leaves, I'm going to get some more before I leave. And I'll modify them a little bit.
So you stock up on some that you can then say, I've got these available now.
Yeah.
Very cool.
That's it.
I'm not sure I followed up with all the. Is it you sell outside of ham radio a little bit?
Oh yeah,
but mostly ham radio.
Yeah, mostly ham radio. But I also do a lot of pet memorials. Like I said earlier, I can take a picture of you, and engrave it on marble, granite. I do a lot of dogs, pets.
They just send you a picture.
They have to send me a high quality. It's got to be a very high quality, 300 ppi or better. And taken at that, not modified into that. It's going to be taken at that.
But a digital picture over the
online. Send it to me digital, and price runs around $100, $150, and it come out extremely good. It'll look just like the picture.
Okay. I don't know that I've seen these, even in Sky Mall or any of the other crappy places. Are you competing with people? You can't be the only person making them.
Well, does here you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well,
there's a guy up there.
The general genre to begin with. You're customizing your stuff. No one else is going to do that.
Right. There's a guy in Ohio that makes something similar to this, but I don't want to degrade it in any way. It's different size. It's different. He makes it with plexiglass. I use glass. I find glass transmits light a lot better than plexiglass does. I guess he's the only competition. I've really never run into him. I ran into a guy yesterday that bought something from me, showed me a picture of it. It looked nice.
Yeah.
But it's the only competition I've seen.
Let's create some competition for you. Is it a good business? Is it taking off for you?
Yeah, it's a good business. It keeps me busy about 60 hours a week. So I'm semi retired.
60 hours a week is, if you were tired or retired, you're not retired anymore.
Nope.
You're working hard.
I started doing this about 7 years ago. Doing engraving a few coffee cups, thought I'd work 10 to 20 hours a week, and it turned into a 60-hour a week business. So yes, it can be very lucrative.
How much time do you spend doing the actual production, and how much time do you have to spend on the business side of the business? Or do you have somebody to take care of the business for you?
I do everything. president, CEO, all the way down to floor sweeper.
Yeah.
So everything in between. Sales.
Mark. Well, of course, you did sales, so you understand doing business. That's probably not as painful for you as it is for me.
Yeah.
So, all right. Well, very, very cool. And we'll have showed some pretty pictures somewhere in this episode.
Okay.
Good luck with it.
Appreciate it very much. Thank you very much.
And when you stuck it on Ham Nation, did that drive serious interest?
Did that drive serious interest?
Yeah.
Did you see the episode where Leo Laporte played with his for about 2 minutes?
I think I did, yeah. I'm sure I've seen them
all. He played with it for about 2 minutes at about 8:15 in the evening. By 9 o'clock, I'd have over $1,000 in business.
Whoa.
And that one show, about $7,000 to $8,000, and so far, Ham Nation alone is responsible for about $13,000 to $14,000 in business.
Wow, that is power. So, do not expect that from this episode.
Okay. Oh, you never can tell.
You might get an order, maybe. we'll find out.
Yeah.
I don't know if you have a way to tell or to track that sort of stuff, but.
Well, I always ask when how do you hear about me, and I got to say the vast majority say Ham Nation.
Cool.
Or from a friend.
This program is Ham Radio Now. Ham Radio Now. Just in
case.
Make
sure you get one of those.
Ooh, cool. Thank you very much, Jim. It's good to meet you.
Thank you very much.
The fist bump thing, and good luck, and stay busy.
Well, thank you very much.
That's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ73, everybody. Next time, over and out.